today what we're going to be doing is working on this question. I chose this question because I think people won't pick it. I think people won't pick it because they won't feel confident to do it. So I wanted to show you how I would approach it confidently. And just because this is how I would approach it, that doesn't mean that there isn't other answers to it.
But there are wrong answers.
There are wrong answers, but even then, like, if you can justify it, you can kind of get yourself a lock. So, so there's two parts.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. Awesome.
Mario.
Oh, come on.
Spectacular headshot.
I mean, I am that.
Could you shove that way a little bit?
Yeah.
Alright.
Yeah. I mean, you might want to feature. Yeah. You do have really nice hair, so it's all, you can't talk about it. Alright.
Keep going. Yes.
Okay. So, can we start? Come on. Let's go. I wanna get this party started. So, there's two parts to this question. There is the I'm going to make this a week you'll never forget. So there's the quote component, which you do have to address at some stage. You can't just ignore the quote completely. I mean, you can, but you're not going to score high end. If you don't mention the quote, you're not going to score high end. And then there's the other bit, which is the it is Lisa who is control in Rear Window. Discuss. Now, because it's a discuss question, that's kind of good for us because it kind of opens a bit of a, like, choose your own adventure activity,
yeah.
Which is really good because, you know, it means that we can kind of go, yes, she's in control, no, she's not in control, there's somebody else in control. We can kind of take it
in
lots of different ways. I kind of went a more steady stream rather than kind of getting adventurous and going it's other people who are in control, just because I felt like that was the more difficult path. I think it's an easy path to go, no, Lisa's not in control, and do a paragraph on that, and then go other people are in control and do a paragraph on those. I thought it was a more difficult task to actually argue yes, she is in control, and then look at various aspects of it. Her controls. So I thought that would be a more interesting and probably an essay that would stand out more too. Because you do have to think strategically, particularly if you're writing as a high-end writer, you can't just write what everybody else is going to write. You've got to think of, I guess, an angle that other people aren't going to think about, that will separate you from the pack, you know, from the seven group. Because it's very hard to jump from 7 to 8, and then 8, 9, 10 is where they kind of start sifting. So what you really want to make sure that you do with your ideas is that you jump out of that 7 pack, and the 7s will still do a very kind of mainstream argument. They'll be very mainstream. Hey, coming in. So that's kind of where I was thinking with this question. So, let's have a look at what I would do with it. So, what are my keywords? First thing I do is look for keywords. What are my keywords? Obviously, this is all key. I have to address that. What are some other things that I have to address in this question?
Control.
Yep. There's Lisa. Yep.
Lisa.
It's Lisa who is in control. Okay. So, once I've kind of done that, then I start thinking, all right, well, do I agree or disagree? And like I said, with this one, I was going to say yes to an extent. I was going to go yes to a certain extent, Lisa is in control. Because I can prove that pretty easily, that Lisa is in control. Sorry, these are my notes. this is how hard I worked for AIM today.
You know what? It's better than me because all I did was think about
it. Oh, yeah, I wrote it down.
Yeah.
All right, so.
But we thought about the same thing, which is awesome.
Yeah, we did. We thought about the same question, which is cool. So, what is the most obvious way that I can say, yes, she is in control? What is she, what is like the most obvious proof that she's in control?
Cinematic.
Like she's moving around, like she's the active participant kind of thing.
Yeah.
I would say even more obvious than that, she's the one that solves the murder. Like she's the one that solves the crime. Yeah? Or solves the fact that there is a crime. Because the interesting thing about this text is that it takes the crime out of crime fiction and it goes, we're not actually considering like who is the murderer. The question is, was there a murder? Which is a definite twist on crime fiction. Usually the crime fiction genre goes, there was a murder, who did it, right? But there's a twist on crime fiction where it goes, there might have been a murder, was there? Like, that's an interesting take on crime fiction. Yes?
She exerts her physical control over Jeff.
Good, all right, carts before horses. I just want to write down my most obvious place, otherwise he'll... So, the murder. She solves the murder.
I'm going to use the word mystery.
The mystery. Yeah. She solves the mystery. Yeah, like she doesn't solve the murder. The murder, The mystery. Sorry, I'm going to write extra big, so hopefully it turns up on that. Okay, so she solves the mystery. And you would think that, like, a high-end response... You would think a high-end response, like, that's too obvious. You still need to hit the obvious. With a high-end response, you still need to hit the obvious stuff. It would be weird if you wrote this essay and you never talked about the fact that she solves the mystery. Yep.
The only reason we were talking is because she came up with the weird Freudian thing. Because we're filming it, I'm not going to say.
Good idea.
Proceed.
Okay. So, she solves the mystery. So, even a high-end result will address the fact that she solves the mystery. Because it would be remiss of you to leave it out.
Yes.
Okay?
You can't leave out the obvious just because you want to stick it.
Yeah, because you're like, I'm being high-end. I'm not going to talk about the fact that there was a murder. It's like, it's a crime story. You must talk about the
murder.
Okay? So, she solves the mystery. That would be good. The things that I would kind of include in that is that she's the physical participant. She's the one climbing the fences, jumping in the windows. She's the one getting dirty. Not metaphorically, literally. Okay? But maybe also she's got the lingerie, you know? She's got the lingerie. See what I did there?
She did good there.
She does the leg work.
She does.
Literally.
She actually is the one who finds the evidence. All
she puts evidence, the reason for not leaving the apartment was the handbag, the ring,
the ring.
She finds out the name.
The names, the letter.
There's a letter?
Yeah, the letter.
The letter.
Oh, yeah.
Names and phone number.
Yes, the names.
No, she gets the number and the, like, what's their name? Gets his name.
She gets the ring.
Alright. So, we've got the most obvious bit, which is, like, she solves the mystery, she does the physical aspects. She climbs through the windows to find the ring. She posts the letter. She's the one that goes down and finds out the name on the post box. She does all the physical stuff. So you have to say that she is in, like, physical control, literal control of the mystery. Yeah? Okay. Lanza.
That's enough. Bless you. Can we, in that same one, and I don't know if I'm overloading it because this is the thing I'm guilty of, can we talk about how we can prove this by juxtaposing her mobility with Jeff's immobility?
Good.
So to prove that she is an active participant versus he's like this flaccid lump, right?
Yeah. Careful when you're throwing around words like flaccid.
Well, no, I'm going to say because I would have a paragraph about emasculating.
Yes,
yeah.
Okay.
He's called emasculating. But that's not at the moment. For this one, I would just use it to juxtapose his immobility, the fact that he's isolated and stuck in that apartment.
Good.
Versus her ability to transform out. She walks in and out, all that stuff. So that's why she's in control in a sense. He thinks he's pulling the strings, but
good.
He's not.
Yeah, so
that could be funny.
You could, with this physicality stuff, you could further prove it by saying, you know, Hitchcock contrasts her involvement, her physical involvement in the murder mystery by Jeff's lack of involvement, by his immobility. That he has to send out minions to do his work. He can't do it himself.
Yes.
So it kind of even further shows that she's the one in control.
She doesn't do what he says. She enters the apartment.
Yeah.
She does all these things. So yeah. She doesn't even obey him. She doesn't have a problem.
Good, yeah. So another thing that you could even take off there is how she actually takes the mystery from him. Mm. So I love this bit in the film.
Yes.
It makes me really happy. Where they've just kind of seen the flower bed thing and how Lisa says, oh, I've always wanted to meet Mrs. Thorwald, and they start planning to dig up the body, whatever it is, that's in the flower garden, and they're talking about it, and they're like, oh, you could get, you know, I'm sure there's a shovel in the basement, blah, 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 and Jeff starts to protest, and they turn to him and go, oh, if you're a bit squeamish, just don't look.
Yeah.
And so it's no longer his domain anymore. They're taking over.
Yeah.
Just don't look, you precious little creature who can't handle a bit of gooby blood. You know, they emasculate him in that moment.
Mm.
They become the ones in control,
yeah.
And he can't do anything about it. And then when they go down there and they're like digging up and they don't find anything, and Lisa goes, I'm gonna leg it up the fire escape. Again, he doesn't like this and he's getting really angry, but he's stuck in the chair,
yeah.
Isn't he? And he's like, what's he doing? You know, like he gets all stuttery. He can't do anything. He's stuck. She's in control. She's making her own decisions.
Yeah.
Okay, so. How do I put that? Okay. So what was the quote? If you're squeamish, just don't look.
Just
don't
look. Most people will go like a 5-6
and at 7:30, we'll go, Lisa is in control because she solves the mystery, 1, 2, 3.
Or Lisa's in control, Jeff's in control.
Yeah, they'll do a character, character, character. Or if they're like a 6, they'll go, she solves the mystery, bang, bang,
oh,
bang.
Oh, yeah, that's what you're saying.
Whereas you're going, this is just, I'm just starting now. I'm just getting started. So that makes them happy because they're like, oh, you've got more ideas than just like the most obvious one. Okay, then I went with a symbolism paragraph.
Yes.
Because I feel like there's a lot of symbolism surrounding this. And I think it's good as well because it's such a clear kick in the goal of authorial intent stuff. So I can really kind of trot out all my like authorial intent knowledge. I can trot out all my cinematic knowledge. Like I can just really go to town with all that stuff that they love. So, I would do, if I can manage my pens. Oh, by the way, like half of these are yours.
Keep
from last.
I've got a drawing.
Yeah, no, because you're the captain.
No, 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 Bond, no, no, no. They're sitting there. Oh. One of the members of the team took a whole box and went away.
Usually I know it came from Cheer Up. Did it come from Cheer Up?
Yeah, I came from Jay. Indirectly.
You kind of passed it through. You always get credit from me though, Cheer Up. Shot from a low angle. Alright. So, yes, you could use the low angle. It's not a good angle.
And
we need like some sort of like filter.
Often when they're arguing too, she'll be slightly raised or on the same level, which suggests that what she has to say is just as or more important as what Jeff has to say, and therefore the audience is inclined to support Lisa. And often the light is shining on her, saying, "Look, you know,
what did you write for this one, Megan?"
That was one of them. And then Chirag and co.
Yes.
Contributed the fact that she literally wears the pants. I know I'm not wearing pants, I'm wearing a jumpsuit, but like, the thing is the same.
And although
she literally wears the pants at the end.
And although she's reading the book on the Himalayas, she's doing the watching.
Good.
She's watching him. He looks like a little lost puppy dog, asleep, and then she switches the books to her little fashion bag.
She doesn't.
To say, I haven't given up my identity for you, fella. I've retained it. And it also shows her independence from him, that I can pursue my own interests.
Good.
I had one too.
What's the magazine again?
Bizarre.
Harper's Bizarre.
Yeah. Because when they argue, she's always higher.
I feel like I spelled Bizarre wrong too.
It's
B-A-Z-A-R. Mine was
Bazaar,
no. It's definitely not. It's not. B-I-Z.
So,
B-A-Z-A-A-R. Bazaar.
B-I-Z.
Bazaar.
No, it's Bazaar.
It's not away. It's not away. Situation.
Yeah, I'm using symbolic as in like the descriptor rather than
the
length. Oh,
okay, because cool, I'm like, what symbols? And I'm like, what?
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
No, that's camera.
The other thing that I've got is that she's the one that closes the blinds.
Yeah, she does.
She closes the blinds on him, not, like, he doesn't get to decide when they don't watch. She decides when they don't watch.
And then the babbling happens.
Okay? And in fact, you could pair. Thank you. You could compare. You could add with that close the blind one about how she says he says. Oh well, you know, maybe I'll watch his torso, and she goes, no, you won't. You know, even if it means that I have to do the dance of the seven veils every night.
Yes.
She.
What is that?
Oh, it's like a
Salome. No, but Salome does that to get the head of John the Baptist. Mm. Salome's mother wants the head of John the Baptist, so she does a sexy dance.
Yeah.
He gets a bit thrilled and he gets his head cut off. Mm. So it's sort of, controls.
Read your Bible.
I know. Get in there.
Read your Bible.
Well, just wait. Yeah. Ladies, gents, see how. The fact that she chooses when they watch and when they don't watch, that's important because she's obviously the one that is in control of this whole situation. You know, she's making all the calls, not just the call about the mystery, but all of these other littler calls too. The last paragraph that I decided to do, just to be like a bit fancy pants, because, you know, I'm not wearing pants, but kind of pants.
Oh, they're fancy.
They're
fancy.
Pretty much as pants as I get, so. The last one that I said, and because I've had a few people who have wanted to try out doing a paragraph like this, is doing like a bit of a like 21st century feminist paragraph.
Ooh.
Just for something different.
And I'll be honest.
What's
that?
Yeah.
So Mr. Schultz is actually doing something a bit clever because literary perspectives were recently introduced in Year 12 literature.
Yeah.
So, and that means that a lot of the people who are assessors are often literature teachers. And
even if they're not, they're people who are educated at a higher level in English. So
yeah.
They have done literary perspectives university. They will find that kind of shiz interesting.
They will. So if you do something to the gender, if we throw that in.
Yeah, yeah. So what I'm doing is technically called literary perspectives, and technically you don't have to know that level of, like, fanciness, but if you did,
yeah,
you could.
It's like you're watching.
Right? So basically, yeah, basically literary perspectives is like, yeah, you watch a film or you look at something through a certain perspective. So for instance, you could look at it as, like, a postmodern perspective.
Mm.
And go, okay, so as a 21st century person, how would this very old text be interpreted? Okay? Or you could go, I'm going to look at this from a feminist perspective. And so imagine myself as a feminist, which isn't too hard, watching a text and going, well, how would a feminist feel about the things that are occurring? Or a colonial perspective, a colonialist perspective. So going, okay, well, as a colonialist, a person who has, you know, taken over a country, how would they perceive this information? How would this be conveyed? Does that make sense? So a really easy one for this text is obviously a feminist perspective and a 21st century feminist perspective, because obviously, you know, 21st century, and we should all be feminists because we want women to have equal rights to men. Doesn't mean that we're better than them, just that we're the same, okay? We should all be feminists. Anyway, I'll get off my high horse. There we go. Okay. So what we could do is a 21st century feminist perspective. Okay. And that would be really fancy. They would be like, ooh, ooh, fancy. They would love that. Hopefully I won't get any complaints from parents, like, telling them that I'm pregnant. But it wouldn't be an answer. And that'll, like, make it So Cam's going to be a little quick. I know you should be so excited. Alright. Are we ready? Is you ready? Okay, let's do it. Okay, so a 21st century feminist perspective of this film would look at this and going, is Lisa really in control? Do you think a 21st century feminist would consider Lisa to be the one in control in this relationship? What do you think? I think they would debate it. Definitely. What problems would a 21st century feminist have with this?
In the kissing scenes, they're highly sexualized.
They are, but I don't think a 21st century feminist would have any problem with that.
No,
they don't mind the sexy time. They're okay with kissing.
So, they have to get married.
Good, the emphasis on marriage. And the fact that even at the end, Lisa doesn't get what she wants. What does she want? She wants him. She wants to actually marry him. She doesn't get what she wants. In fact, if we want to go further than that, does Lisa actually get what she wants? She asks for him to give up his job, to live in New York, wear a nice flannel suit, and take portraits. Does she get that?
No.
No. What does she get instead? The option to put on pants and go in the jungle.
The Himalayas.
And follow him. Yeah, she has to follow him. She has to follow him. So I think from a 21st century feminist perspective, you could argue that Lisa is not in control because ultimately she does not get to choose her own kind of path. She has to choose his path.
You could kind of argue that with the whole idea, the very final scene when she puts down the book and picks up her own magazine, which kind of says, I'm not...
But she
not,
has to do that once he's
yeah,
asleep.
But, I'm not, but she doesn't...
Watch
she
reminds me of it up at the beginning, man.
Yeah.
Like, no,
she's
got to
pretend that she's something that she's not.
She
that's what I would say from, like, a feminist reading, that's what they would
she's
say.
She's acquiescing.
Yeah.
But she's not sacrificing her entire... identity.
No, but
she's
she sacrifices
everything.
A big part of
it. It is a huge part of it.
Her public.
She's
her public
all
part.
Up. It's like if she's going out the back and
she's not seeing everything. Another way she wouldn't fit up. She's seeing everything to his face. She's also doing watching. So once again, she's also doing watching. She's doing watching. She's watching.
Oh, look, there's definitely lots of, like, perspectives on it, and I'm not saying that this is the answer, but I'm saying if we talked about this from a 21st century...
No,
from a feminist perspective, that's what the reader would be. Yeah. Like, if we were doing a... Yeah, from a feminist perspective, that's what they would really say. Guys, I want to be able to hear Adelaide, and there's a lot of extra talk going on. Adelaide. Yeah, Jeff doesn't give up anything. So that would be another thing that we could add with this, is that she gives up her, you know, her dresses, her pearls, her lifestyle. She gives up her lifestyle for him. Moreover, he doesn't give up anything for her. He continues the same way he's always been. Jeff?
He's also entirely
independent. Alright, so that would be a really interesting paragraph for them to receive, because certainly not a lot of people would think of doing that.
No,
you can definitely go further. Like, there are other things, so you could talk about how there's the emphasis on marriage, that she is, you know, bound by this idea of having to pursue a relationship with him.
Well, she's not complete until she's married.
She's not complete until she's married, or coupled. Well, she's not married at the end.
No.
She's not wearing a ring. So, yeah, she's not complete until she's got the man. But also you could talk about how there is this real emphasis on her looks.
There's no real
emphasis ever, and Jeff never draws attention to the fact that she's incredibly intelligent. Her worth is in her looks.
Exactly, and that's coupled by the quote, pay attention to me, what's a girl got to get your attention? Is this, well, she's got to be attractive.
Yeah.
And it's all about the worth, the value judgment on the way you look rather than your brains. And even though she's incredibly intelligent, yeah, you're right, yeah, you never want praise her. Or you know, Lisa, you're perfect, you're beautiful, what else do you want from me? She never praises
her. And even Stella, Stella says, you know, she's the perfect woman for every man with half a brain and one eye open, saying she's perfect because she is beautiful. Not because she's brilliant.
True. I suppose gives up nothing with me. He does not see any of his controls.
Oh, it's Scottish.
Yeah, he doesn't concede any control. But this would be like, this is just my essay.
Well, I would actually argue that, I'll cut you off.
No, go ahead.
I would argue that you could basically argue that the final paragraph is your actual whiz bang killer paragraph.
Yeah.
And we still need to address, in the introduction, you'd be addressing the quote, obviously. But that whiz bang paragraph, you'd be talking about she's in control of, in as much as she chooses to participate in the mystery.
Yeah.
So I actually wouldn't give much weight to the marriage stuff, because that just feels like I've got to give you, like, they're all valid points.
Yeah.
But really, how does that respond to the topic?
Yeah, that's true.
Do you
that's
know,
true.
Really
yeah.
Good. I mean, Miss Richardson
so
raised
even,
this for you guys to be able to have this idea,
yeah.
Head, but it's not like.
But you could also take it back to, like you were saying,
she's
I think
in some
is,
elements.
Yeah, that she, and also, like, you know how she's the one doing all the legwork.
Yeah.
She's doing all the legwork to solve the mystery. But she's doing it for him.
I disagree.
You could argue it. I'm not saying I agree with it. And sometimes I write paragraphs that I'm like, I don't really agree with this.
Yeah.
But it goes with my argument,
yeah.
So I don't really care. Like,
so
it suits what I'm arguing,
I agree.
So I don't really care. So you could argue that actually all of the things about her being in control, solving the mystery, could, from a different perspective, be seen as her running around doing his legwork, being his girl Friday,
not actually
doing it for herself.
She's also in control in as much as she's, I mean, to add on, to the only way, the way you can connect that, and I'm sure that's what you already thought, is the idea that she's the one who is controlling the romance. She's the one who's trying to steer the ship, and that ties in perfectly with the quote.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, well, this is what the other thing I was going to say is we really still need to work in the quote. And the way that I would kind of work in the quote is probably here, maybe talking about the relationship and going that she is in control of the relationship. But I feel like, from a 21st century perspective, they would say she's not in control of the relationship because he is ultimately the one that puts the ring on the finger. He's the one that decides whether they stay together or not.
Yes. Could you link that then to that quote, to the objectiveness of the female, getting back to your point, the control, you're succeeding your control because of the objectify of women of the 21st century by the suitcase and overnight, the overt sexuality is succeeding control?
You could. Sorry.
You could.
That's just one interpretation of how you could do this question. Just one. There's plenty of other ways. I'm sure Lanza had a completely different way. But if you're wanting to look to have something to write, you could have a go at writing this now that it's planned and organised and
sorted
for you.
I think that's brilliant. I think you did a great job.
Well done.
I feel like I got claps here. If I got claps, then I'd be doing this more often. If I get
cool fruits.
I don't like cool fruits that much. It's okay. They're okay, but it's not like my
go-to.
Okay. The next one that I want to do. I had two stickers. I want to do the Hitchcock uses his cinematic style to explore the idea of social constructs. The second last question. Oh yeah, yeah. Can you take a photo and send it to me as well?
That is the grossest of all the boys.
Sorry for being so close, guys. Oh, look at my pimple.
Oh, that was a bad look. Sorry.
watch this. So, leaving that aside, doing it through three techniques is the wrong way to do it. So what you actually go is, I'll flip to the other one. And I could talk about three social construct things. I could talk about three social constructs instead. Luckily, in this case, we have loads of social things that are going on that are being commented on. And you can kind of choose your own adventure. The ones that I decided to pick, these are the four that I kind of went with. Wait, that's the wrong poster though. Where's the other one? Oh, thank goodness. Because I'll forget my name. So, disconnectedness from society. The social disconnects.
My kids. Smash this.
Oh, I'm not the chief examiner, Lisa.
No, but
yeah.
We just pretend.
I'm not the chief
examiner.
from society. Gender roles. If you didn't do something on gender, they'd be like you kind of missed the elephant in the room. Another good one to do would be like McCarthyism and suspiciousness. Marriage and sexuality.
Yes.
Oh. Sorry. I'll try and like... No, that's not helping either. Okay. Don't want to put that in the atmosphere. Maybe go closer. God forbid, closer. All right. Whoa. Okay. Just don't look at it. I was kind of thinking maybe a marriage and sexuality one would be kind of a good fourth, if I wanted a fourth. It's always kind of good to plan four, and then if you have time, particularly because we're giving you 90 minutes instead of the hour, yeah? Like 90 minutes is actually a fair bit of time to like hash out something. So particularly like under like pressure, you can get quite a lot out. So it's good to kind of brainstorm a fourth. If you've got time, you can slash it out. If you don't, then you can just cut it, whatever. So marriage and sexuality might be a nice one to do as well. Just as a thought. What would I kind of say? So cinematic style to explore the idea of the social construct of disconnection. What kind of cinematic techniques can I talk about? Trav is dying. He's dying. Panache,
The framing,
Okay, I like that. Yeah, so each kind of apartment is all very separate, and they're like separate cells.
Yeah.
You know, that we watch, we never kind of see them combine until the end where we see like some of them hook up. But yeah. Why am I writing in red? Red's hard to read. Each of what would you call them? What do you call them? Like peripheral characters?
Oh, okay. I refer to the apartments.
Secondary?
Yeah. So the separate both physically and in the like interaction.
Brains. Disconnected. They are literally like disconnected
from
each other. So yeah, they're disconnected. How else? So the framing works really well. I like that a lot, Panache, especially because I don't think a lot of people would think of it. And it's good to kind of go with ones that are not so stock standard. Let's hear from Lisa.
Look at Jeff in the nature of his job as a photojournalist who's trained.
But he's always behind the
lens.
He's
always behind the lens. And then it goes from eyes to binoculars to telephoto lens, which further distances emotional connections to his relationship.
Okay, so the technique will be the camera?
Yep.
Okay.
Or even symbolism of the camera.
Yeah. Is that a cinematic technique?
Here's what I've been talking about, to join it onto that. Did anybody else think about how Jeff has isolated himself within the text?
Could we make that another paragraph?
That he's like stuck in the...
Well, they put him in a separate room, so he's distant.
Oh, yeah, he's across the way. Yeah, okay, so I can put that in here.
Yeah.
Go further from this.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have a question. Is the cinematic style or a technique, would that be symbolism? Was the symbolism of the camera? It's just a question. Would the symbolism of the camera be a technique?
It's your intro, you saw
better.
Better
from this.
Just sort of it.
You
are.
Better
from this. Just
Jeff,
physical isolation.
Jeff's apartment.
Yes, physically isolated from the others. So you could argue that Hitchcock has created a set that physically isolates each of the narratives of the text.
Is it half past, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Well, if you want to leave, that's cool. Just do it quietly and we'll just do a little bit more. Anything else that we want to add with disconnected from society, or do you want to move on because we've got to finish this up? All right. Gender roles, what would we say? What cinematic techniques would you use for gender roles? We could use what we used in the last essay and do the camera angles. We could do the camera angles again.
Angles, levels. Angles, long shots and close shots.
Yeah, how do we use those to emphasize gender roles? What about the low, high angles? Like, you know, they always shoot Lisa from like a low angle, so she looks kind of taller and more in power.
Or when he's in the wheelchair and police bloke comes in and he's standing, so it's like he has more.
He's taller and stuff.
Because he's so is that talking about gender roles though?
Yes. What about how they have Lisa and Stella in between Jeff in the middle? You can see that their heads are all over there. And
his is kind of down.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
They're pretty much looking down on him.
Yeah. Okay. So why don't we do like we'll do one on camera angles and do that low angle thing.
So you would argue that in terms of gender roles, Hitchcock.
Whoa! You went into a weird place.
Yeah. I have no idea how that happened.
When did Maxim get here?
That is a good question. When did Maxim get here?
He was doing other stuff.
Okay.
He's just
one.
So I was thinking you could argue that Hitchcock basically, by putting Jeff in the wheelchair and making him a mobile. I know I keep going back to that, but it's that feminist thing, you know. So you go, by putting him in the wheelchair, that means that every shot that that any other character is in with Jeff, Jeff is always going to come across as, well, the cinematic construct of general. So the women are physically going to come across as more powerful, more in control, simply because Hitchcock has put him in a chair.
Yeah, and that's a, that's still a cinematic technique. Like he's using props, and he's going, I want Jeff to be powerless. I'll put him in a wheelchair so he's smaller than everybody else. Because like
that's authorial intent.
Who's ever broke their leg and then hired a wheelchair for 6 weeks? You don't. You use crutches, man.
Yeah.
They had crutches back then. That's not a complicated piece of science. You know, they're putting him in that on purpose. No one hires a wheelchair because they break a leg. AJ?
Would you consider dialogue as cinematic style?
If you're talking about maybe how they use their tone of voice or how it's paired with something that's happening, yes. Otherwise, probably not. Yeah. Okay, let's do a McCarthyan suspicion just to kind of wrap this baby up so that if you wanted to write it, you could. So McCarthyan suspiciousness, how does he kind of examine that social construct? Yeah, but how does he use cinematics to do it?
The telephoto.
What is it? The long focus lens? Telephoto lens, okay.
What about the helicopter? Yeah,
the time to play it is very
And you could kind of do the telephoto lens and say, you know, that's kind of like looking in, and because like he solves the mystery, it actually gives permission to look, and also because Stella and Lisa give us permission to look. Yep.
So I think in front of the whole department, because again, there's a red bloke. There's a way that you can link it with the communism sort of style, and then
the red's under men. Yep. Yeah, okay. That is a really interesting interpretation, which Damon will be really excited to hear tomorrow. AJ has drawn a connection with the red light, and perhaps the idea of communism, because communism was associated with reds, like reds under the bed.
Yep.
That's a great connection. Why not?
It's an extrapolation, but it's there.
It's a word.
Well,
who's the first person who decided the murder of a communist?
Hey, I bought that red light.
You can't ignore the dog. Social construct. So, contrary to McCarthy's, the traditional social construct is this idea of neighbours looking out for each other.
For each other.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
I mean, you can pop that in.
Yeah, definitely. Cool. But I think these guys are just about. Does anyone else have anything that they quickly want to add? Otherwise, we might wrap it up because it looks like you guys are cooked.
Miss the lighting, maybe in the housing, how they've got well, they figured out the buildings first of all, like the bits that you can't see, and then have the lighting too, especially smoking.
Oh, like when the light's off.
Yeah,
where would I use that?
Yeah.
Oh, he's acting suspiciously, and how he's got the little like cigar.
Yeah.
And it's
like why they're living in the dark? So they still have the cigarette.
Well, there's
but I don't know how you work that in though.
Well, what you could actually argue is that Hitchcock suggests that American society, post-1950s American society, is not this idyllic safe place.
Yeah.
Right? That bad things happen in these neighbourhoods.
Yeah.
And reiterated by bad things happening in the dark.
Yes, that's the narrative.
And bad people live in the dark. So
that's
the social construct of the 1950s.
No
1950s, no one locked the door. Stella didn't lock the door. Thor just walked in.
That's so true.
Right, so...
Actually, I had a few kids say that. They're like, why didn't she lock the door? I'm like, nobody locks doors.
It's the 50s, right?
Yeah.
So...
You say the 50s, it's still, like, the same at my parents' house. Like, literally, my dad has never locked our doors. Yeah. Look,
I don't care. You, I mean, really.
You should be putting, like, bars on
your
doors. All right, so I think we'll leave it there because I feel like everyone is cooked as a goose. You've got two essays now and no excuses.
Let's
so
get one before.
Hurry up and write. Hurry up and write. Yes. Look, Maxim. Except you get a really hideous view at me at one point. Ugh.